On February 9th, 1980, at Madison Square Garden in New York City, they skated onto the ice to play a fundraising exhibition game, just 3 days before the start of the Olympics. But to their opponents on this night, it wasn't just an exhibition. Because any time the Soviet Union's top team played against Americans, they played to win. The Soviets had just recently embarrassed the NHL All-Stars in a three-game series, winning the Challenge Cup on American ice. With the Olympics only days away, they were rolling over opponents like a red tidal wave.
They were the Red Menace, and they wore the CCCP across their chests, and they were very, very intimidating.
You had heard about them. You'd known how good they were. You'd known about their successes, and now you were going to play them. And that night, it was welcome to the real world, boys.
We got crushed, and we thought, these guys are in another world.
They just kicked us around that rink. The goals they scored were, you could have filmed them. They were so beautiful.
They were like robots. When they scored a goal, they never smiled. I don't think I ever saw them smile.
We were all ready to stand up and applaud them, because we didn't see anything like that before. You know, guys hitting elbow, did you see that goal? Did you see his move? It's like, we were spectators.
I looked up at the scoreboard. It said 10-3. It might as well have said 20-0. 10-3 made it sound closer than it was. It was no contest.
There couldn't have been a greater low point, given the preparation and the work that we had put in. It was very demoralizing.
This dose of hockey reality brought U.S. hopes back to Earth. As each team left New York City for upstate Lake Placid, their futures seemed clear.
Anybody who left Madison Square Garden that day thought to themselves, the Soviets will win every game in the Olympics, take home the gold medal, and never be challenged. And the U.S., all you knew is that when it came time to face the big bear, they had no chance.
No one was expecting a showdown between the Americans and the Soviets. The teams were in separate brackets and would play only if each got to the medal round. The Soviets were expected to be there. The Americans weren't.
I know you guys are really facing a Herculean task here. It's like sending you into the lion's cage. Do you feel like that?
Yes, we do. You know, you got to be realistic about things. We're a young team. We're the youngest Olympic hockey team ever. If you had to pick us, I think we'd probably be picked fifth.
We were anticipating getting the gold medals because we were the strongest team. The Czech team wasn't very strong. The Swedes weren't strong either. The Americans never really counted as an opponent. Therefore, there was nobody really to compete with.
The Soviets barely had to compete in the early rounds, as they breezed past Japan and the Netherlands by a combined score of 33-4. The Americans opened against heavily favored Sweden, and playing a nervous and tentative game, trailed 2-1 late in the final period.
I remember the U.S. had several opportunities to tie the game, and you just got the feeling, and of course, as the clock ticks down and now you're under a minute, well, it's not to be.
With only 41 seconds left, Brooks pulled Jim Craig from the goal, putting an extra skater on the ice, but leaving the American net empty. It was a desperate move for a desperate team.
Fighting for control of the puck with 29 seconds to play. Baker on it, buddy!
He was just trying to get it on net. And I couldn't believe it when it went in, you know.
Look at that scene on the ice!
You can always wonder, if Billy doesn't score, what happens to the hockey team? Well, Billy did score.
And the Americans in the key game, in the first round, tie it up!
That was the biggest goal of the Olympics, because if the Americans lose that game, they're virtually out of contention before the Olympic Games start.
As the horn sounds to end it, the U.S. 2 and Sweden 2.
2 days later, the Americans faced Czechoslovakia, underdogs again, in a game they had to win.
Many people said that the Czechs were considered the second best team in the world and the only team that had a chance to beat the Soviets. We pretty much dominated the Czechs.
Late in the third period, As the Americans were skating to a 7-3 victory, Mark Johnson was knocked to the ice from a cheap shot by a Czechoslovakian player.
The injured American player right there, number 10, Mark Johnson.
As Johnson lay injured, Americans watching on television were introduced to Herb Brooks, up close and personal.
Bury that goddamn stick right in your throat.
Herb Brooks, it was in the inglorious moment.
Eat that goddamn go-go tree.
If you're going to do something to our guy, I'm going to take this stick and I'm going to stuff it down your throat. People were ready to hear that kind of thing. He would not have sat back and let the Ayatollah stomp all over the U.S. while holding a bunch of hostages.
I think that was one of the moments where a lot of people in this country said, hey, we've got a pretty good little story taking place here. We have these fresh-faced kids, got to keep an eye on these guys. And look at this coach. I mean, he's right there, backing his players.
Now you get a tie against the Swedes, you get a win over the Czechs, and you can sense it starting to build. You can sense the interest in America. They're now taking notice of these kids who are starting to turn this tournament on its ear.
So everybody's starting to look ahead to this prospective matchup against the Soviets, but before that, you have three other games. Norway figured to be the easiest of the games, and it was.
There is Pavlich, who gets it back to Silk, who scores! Davy Silk from Mark Pavlich.
Then you had Romania.
Breston, he scores! Dave Breston!
And they won that game. Germany presented a little bit of a problem, though, on Wednesday night, the last game prior to going into the medal round. Germany leads 2-0. So wait a second, what's going on here? You don't want this bump in the road. You don't want it now. And then the U.S. is able to come from behind and beat Germany. So they did all of the things they had to do. But then, of course, you had the specter of the Soviets just looming there.
The Soviets, looming in the medal round, with an undefeated record and overflowing confidence. Seemingly no one, certainly not a bunch of college kids, could stop them from winning the gold medal.
One of the ministers of the Soviet sport who was responsible for hockey, he told that basically, you know, guys, I'm not congratulating you yet, but we're very close. Czechoslovakian team didn't qualify. Americans are students. We beat them any time of the day or night. We are on top of the world already.
We were way stronger. Nobody ever doubted that. We were professionals, and they were just students. Simply put, we did not respect that team, and you cannot do that in hockey.
The first medal round game had been scheduled months in advance for Friday, February 22nd at 5 p.m. Not exactly prime time. But then nobody had expected it would be a match between the world's superpowers at a moment of escalating international tension.
There was some talk about the game being shifted from 5 o'clock to 8 o'clock because people wanted national television. We were told, the Soviets said, absolutely not, the game will be played at 5, like schedule.
So ABC Television made the decision to tape the game at 5, but wait until 8 to broadcast it.
So here, in this just most bizarre and freakish circumstance, you have a 5 o'clock game on a Friday where people are filing into a building in daylight, going to a semi-matinee. Little would anybody understand that it would be, you know, maybe the most memorable sports event they would ever go to in their lives.
The excitement, the tension building, the Olympic Center building to capacity. I'm sure there are a lot of people in this building who do not know the difference between a blue line and a closed line. It's irrelevant. It doesn't matter, because what we have at hand, the rarest of sporting events, an event that needs no buildup, no superfluous adjectives.
In the locker room before the game, Herb Brooks gave the speech of his life.
He told us we were born to be a player, we were meant to be here, this moment was ours.
And he told that story about going up and spitting in the eye of the tiger.
But I remember they taking the first step and looking up and around, and it was packed, overflowed, flags everywhere.
There was a buzz, an electricity around the arena.
USA against Russia. USA against Russia.
The intensity and the hatred is incredible. You don't want to hit somebody against the boards. You want to put them through the boards.
And I remember a telegram we got from a lady in Texas, and all the telegram said was, beat those commie bastards.
You realized that the USA on the front of your sweater meant that you were playing for your country.
For decades, The Cold War had a way of flaring up in all sorts of hot spots. On this day, it would be a small hockey rink in a little town in the Adirondack Mountains. On this day, February 22nd, 1980, the only thing placid around here was the lake.
Here we go as the game is underway. The Soviet Union in red and the United States in white.
I remember for the first 5 or 6 minutes feeling as though I couldn't feel my feet on the ice.
The Americans sensed even a couple minutes in that this was going to be a little different game.
They were skating with a determination and purpose they had not shown earlier against the Soviets at Madison Square Garden.
The Americans were so strong in the first period, it was unexpected for us. They played very fast and very emotionally in all aspects.
It made no difference. The Soviets struck first.
Buzz Snyder losing it out to the point. Slap shot, and it was deflected in. And the Soviet Union leads 1-0 at the 9-12 mark of the first period.
The Russians scored first, and you winced and thought, here it comes. But the U.S. team took that blow. Craig made some key saves. And then Buzzy Schneider came down the left wing.
Pavlich up ahead to Schneider. Shot goes in! Buzz Schneider! That's the type of goal you don't expect somebody like Krediak to give up. And the United States ties the game at 14:03 in the period.
The tying goal failed to unnerve the Soviets. They quickly scored again, and it looked like the first period would end with them leading 2-1. But with just seconds remaining, the methodical team that almost never made mistakes made the worst kind, a mental error. And it changed the course of the game.
Davy Christian has the puck. It's about 5 seconds left to go in the period. I start to skate to the bench thinking the period's over.
And I remember seeing Mark Johnson go, scoot, no. Like, he just didn't stop playing. He was still playing. The Russians had stopped.
That made it 1-0. Long shot, the easy save by Krediak, but Johnson is in!
I was going hard to the net. The defenseman just sort of let me go by him. I picked the puck up off a rebound and was able to put the puck in.
We relaxed a little bit. We thought that the period was over and the horn would sound. Unfortunately, that was a big mistake.
The bigger mistake, as far as Herb Brooks was concerned, was that the Soviets weren't taking the Americans seriously.
He had said it all week when he was teasing the Russians. These guys think they're going to walk through everybody. Look how cocky they are. They're not here to play hockey. They're here to trade jeans and, you know, have a vacation and go home with the gold medal. They're not serious about this.
But Soviet coach Viktor Tikhonov was serious. So much so that he did the unthinkable and replaced the best goalie in the world.
I went to the locker room and was preparing to play on. But Tikhonov came in and said, Krediak is playing poorly and will not play in the second period. That was it.
But the new Soviet goaltender didn't have to worry in the second period because his teammates were playing like they wanted to end the illusion that the Americans really had a chance. They quickly scored the go-ahead goal. And dominated the action, outshooting the Americans 12-2 in the second period. Only Jim Craig's brilliance in goal prevented the game from becoming a blowout.
Slap shot, saved by Craig, save off the rebound, and a whistle.
My goal in every game was to keep the team that I played for in a position to win.
Now to Pervukin. Pervukin's slap shot is covered up by Jim Craig.
If you're going to beat a team as good as they were, you needed your goaltender to play well. And when we did make mistakes, Jimmy came up with big saves.
And the second period is over. The Olympic Ice Center is still the Soviet Union 3 and the United States 2.
We're only a goal down. We'd been there throughout the Olympic Games. We were down to Sweden. We were down to West Germany. This is no big deal. No big difference for us. Just keep playing, keep going.
It comes down to that last 20 minutes, and now you've got a hockey game, and one that you can have a chance to win at.